So my idea here is that, you know, Professor Kelkar is here, who has been a practicing manager for quite some time. So with due permission from Mr. Kelkar, with an assumption that he wouldn't be asking me too difficult questions, let me start. Okay. Now what I would like to first state is, you know, what does the theory say? Theory says that you will have requirement analysis and then detailed analysis. You will do design, then you will do development and unit testing, then you will do functional testing or integration testing or system testing. All of them will integrate together, and then you may do this in a waterfall life cycle model, that is phase after phase you do the requirements, you complete the requirements, you do the analysis, then you do the design, then you do the development. Or alternatively, you do it in iterative fashion, you know, you do a several phases of elaboration. Some of you must have been already experienced in RUP. In RUP model, you do an elaboration, then you do second phase of elaboration, phase 3, phase 4, etc. Now, what I am not going to talk about is how do you do elaboration, or what kind of a MS project tool would help you, you know, how do you draw a project plan using MS project. That is not the intent of the presentation, because I think that is theory. What I would like to tell you is what happens when you actually do a project. Okay. Now, what happens in reality is the first question that comes up is who is responsible for what. I mean, there is a lot of people mistake that project management is technology management. It is technology management, but it is not just technology management. It is more people management, it is more expectation management, it is more of commercial management. To be a successful project manager, you have to have an extraordinary sense of commercials of how the projects work. So first question that will be asked is who is responsible for what during the project execution. When I say execution, I am not limiting myself to either one phase or another phase, any other phase, who is responsible for what. The second question is what is the right technology for the project. Now you normally say that whenever you make a project proposal, whenever you respond to an RFP, or whenever you have a business problem for which you are implementing a technical solution, the natural tendency is at the level of a project winning, everybody will commit the moon. You know, we will say that we will use a web based technology, we will use J2EE, we will use entire architecture to implement it. And then when it actually comes to reality, people, it strikes you as to what is the technology that you are going to use. If you are you going to use for messaging MSQ series, or are you going to use TIBCO? Or for example, if you would you use an application server, WebSphere or WebLogic or iPlanet, you know. The choice of tools is so many, and there is no real one solution to this problem. Now the question is that there are three things that are always everybody knows better than you. One is finance, because everybody in finance, the second guy always knows more about you than finance. Second is medicine also. You know, a lot of people know medicine more than you. They know more than doctors know, because you know everybody has a cure for everybody else's disease. And the third thing is system architecture. So everybody knows better than any other person, because it's easy to ask questions and very difficult to give answers. If you say that, look, you know, why did you choose Java and not .NET? You know, you can only give one or two answers. You know, why not C sharp and why Java? There is only one or two questions. Both are block structured languages. Both are this. Both are that. But after some time, the other guy will have one question for which you don't have an answer. Okay. For example, in real life banking systems that have distributed data processing and are used in Europe, how many places .NET has been used? So you don't know the answer. You know, you don't know the answer. So then why did you choose .NET? So they don't have an answer to those questions. So what is the right technology to be used? The third thing is frequent changes to requirements and even architecture during development. Okay, I'll expand on why it happens in architecture as we go along. But frequent changes to requirements is something that is given. Because in a business domain, we see that changes happen almost every 6 months. I mean, every 6 months is a minimum that you have to accept changes. And large projects have a tendency to get into states where the business itself undergoes a change. For example, I was working on an investment banking firm in New York on what they call mortgage-backed securities. Mortgage-backed securities is when you take a loan on a house from HDFC kind of a bank, the loan papers are amortized and issued as a security to people, so that people will sell and buy those securities. It works in a very different kind of fashion. For example, if you look at mortgage backed securities, whenever the interest rates go up, people won't sell the homes. Whenever it, that means if interest rate goes up, your security prices drop because nobody is interested in buying or selling the shares. Whenever interest rates drop, people would like to cancel their current mortgage and go for the renewal of the mortgage with the second firm. So that means there is a lot of tendency for the paper to go down and paper to go up. With the result, mortgage backed securities almost follow reverse trend of what happens in the marketplace. Now, we were working on a project of master data maintenance and straight through processing system for one of the largest investment banks in the world. And the project proposal was $5 million, you know, about 94-95 is what I am talking about. Now, $5 million was the value of the contract. There was one transaction that hit the desks that costed a loss of about $40 million, one transaction to the investment banking firm. Now, if a $40 million loss happens to a single transaction because of some trader getting overboard, there is no way that they will continue the project. So, the requirements have dramatically changed in that case because there was no project after 1 week, because there was nobody to effort the project, you know. And the other thing is, staffing does not happen at the right time. It is a very different concept, because you know what you normally assume when you start a project is that you have a, you are starting on 1st of October, this project is going to run for 6 months, 25 people, 10 people, 15 people, 8 people, 3 people, you have normally an extraordinarily good Gaussian distribution curve of bell curve that going up and down, you start with 5 people, go to 30 and then gradually you drop. In reality what happens is it always happens in pulses. You are with 2 people for about 2 months, then it comes suddenly to 20 people, then everybody will get released from the project, you will get about 5 people. Okay. Now, why does it happen? It happens because there, first of all, there are several reasons. One is there is water everywhere and no water to drink. There are hundreds of people available in the marketplace, but no good guy who can be employed on projects in a serious way. The level of competence and skills required in the to execute an architecture, to do a decent design, we find it absolutely lacking in the current generation of crop of computer science and engineering students that are joining this. They want to code one program, design one system, participate in the design in one system, be a project coordinator for the third, and the fourth they want to become a CEO. You know, that's where the problem is, you know, and that's where we have the problem. And the other thing that happens is when you say that you are designing a Java J2E based system, so even if you know that you are building this web based system that is purely based on Java, suddenly you will find that when you get into the details, the implementation of Java itself in that particular project has several flavors and people need experts in those flavors. For example, somebody uses struts, you know, are you using struts? If you don't use struts, then if you know all about JTE, if you haven't programmed on struts before, it almost becomes impossible for you to be accepted as that. And suddenly if the project had demand of 40 to 50 people and then you don't know the lowest level of a detail of a skill required for the project, it almost becomes impossible to staff it at the appropriate time. Other thing is infrastructure. I mean, infrastructure, we assume that it is given, but in a large project that has dependencies quite a lot on the customer side, they could be because you are accessing the existing systems, because there could be because you are interfacing with the existing systems of the customer, or because you are carrying out the system testing on the customer side. In each of these things, the first requirement is the connectivity. Okay. Now, I do not know how many of you have worked on distributed delivery delivery process that involves repositories. And if you used a relational unified repository, or if you have used any repository that is used across to on a distributed scale where people from say US or Europe and India are all working on the same repository of use cases, analysis and design and development, quite a only few of the repositories commercially available have a technology, have a method of doing a delta update. Suppose if you have been working for 2 hours here and those guys have been working for 4 hours there, if you have to sync the repositories in real time, the load that is required is very high. So your channel of network communication almost gets blocked because of this repository syncing, because 100 people are working here, 40 people are working there. How well you do sync the repositories, how frequently do you do syncing of the repositories becomes a major issue. That's one part of the network communication. The second part is the load set. Now what we are finding, I think I will probably explain it to the next slide a little more in detail, is that when you are working on a development project, especially on a web-based applications, the kind of a load set that is needed on your PC to get the programmer working, from Java virtual machine to some DLLs, from dynamic libraries, you know, it's almost a set of checklist of things that have to be loaded on a workstation before it becomes a programmable workstation for a programmer. I mean, otherwise it's just a PC. So you need to have this, you need to have that, plus you know, some amount of Microsoft, some amount of, for example, if you are using something like a Documentum as part of your application for workflow or document flow, those DLLs, those dynamic libraries, everything has to be part of it so that you can link edit and then execute the programs. So that becomes a huge set. And creating this load set, ultimately you find that when you create an entire load set, it cannot communicate with the customer machine because there is a version difference between what you loaded here and what you loaded there. So by the time in a large project, which is complex, before you get the things right on the load set of a workstation, our experience is it takes about 2 to 3 weeks. Because people will, you know, everybody assumes that nobody, everybody has this, but everybody in the customer environment has it. They never consider the fact that if you have to give something from Microsoft Windows version XX onwards till the highest load leveling library, you have to give entire set of software that have to be loaded on a workstation to make it productive. So that's, at times you find that you have actually 100 programmers working on your project, but actually 20 are only productive, because other 80 are figuring out how to configure their PCs to be able to make them productive. And the last thing is, this is a clear case of what happens in incremental delivery, which is, you know, like big bang approach of delivery is no longer considered to be appropriate in large development projects. People say, we'll deliver once in 1 month, so you accept, then you accept 2 months. So that everybody thinks that the risks are minimized, but if it works well, risks are minimized. If it doesn't work, risks are actually maximized. So we'll go into the details a little more. Now what I'm saying, what I want to go through in the next 2-3 slides, I'm not going to read through each one of them. Software projects fail because certainly one of the reasons is not that people who are working on it are incompetent. Okay. There may be some amount of incompetence which we can't ignore, but like in any other industry. But essentially software projects fail in spite of the best efforts. I just gave you a list of, for everything that you think that I have presented these details, I just gave a live list of assumptions that the project manager has put when he signed the fixed price contract with the customer. Now everybody wants a fixed price contract in this world, right? So because nobody wants to have a time and material deal where somebody would like to pay, you know, you expect the customer to pay for your own inefficiencies. So they would like to have a fixed price contract. So if you give a fixed price contract, you give lot of assumptions to cover your backside as to what could go wrong. Okay. You are protecting yourself, saying that if this were to go wrong, I am not responsible, you are responsible. You put all these things, but still in reality, it doesn't happen that. Just look at some of the requirement, the assumption that the customer, the project manager has put here. Look at the 1, 2, 3, 4th one. Final deliverables will be approved via written sign off from the appropriate customer project sponsor or designated customer project team member. Any deviations from an approved deliverable may result in a change request. So this guy has completely covered himself, saying that, you know, I'm submitting something, you are signing off. If you change the sign off, look, I'll raise a change request and you have to pay more for that. Okay. Another thing that he is saying is any work product or deliverable presented to the customer must be reviewed within 5 days. The customer does not raise any queries within a 5 days period, the deliverables are deemed to be accepted. You know? So we say that, look, you know, you submitted something, you accept, you know, you say that, you don't say anything. For example, you delivered a design document or you delivered a set of logical programs, for acceptance. For any reason, if you have not done anything, we consider it as accepted. Okay. Now, it will be a great exercise for you, for some of you who are in IT course, just take a development project and write the assumptions. If you are as a project manager, what kind of assumptions would you like to write? You know, say that, you know, it is from requirement definition to implementation. You can take it from analysis to implementation. You can take to design to implementation. You can also assume that the design has been completed. You are just responsible for coding and unit testing. Write, sit back and then try to write down the assumptions that would be needed to execute the project. It will be one of the greatest exercises of commercial software project management that you can do, writing the assumptions and deliverables. So, rest all is detailed in a project. First of all, you write the assumptions. Second, you write the deliverables. What is that you are going to deliver? Content, and what is the, how is that you are going to deliver? The format. Content and format of the deliverables and assumptions is the most important thing in a software project management. This is one list of assumptions that he has done on project management. On development and testing, this is a project where use cases are already done. The gentleman says use cases provided are complete, unambiguous and accurate. So, in reality, you will find that none of them is actually true. They are neither complete nor accurate nor unambiguous. And the other thing is, during integration testing, the vendor will have access to test systems and test regions as applicable. Because lot of customers who are working in an offshoring mode, especially with countries like India, have a tendency to assume that the software will be thrown from the window beyond this wall, and they get up one day morning on September 11th or 12th, depending on the date, they will have a working system that they can log on and then work. Very few people actually estimate the nature of a work that need to be done from the customer side to get this offshore work going, okay, in terms of their ability to work late nights, their ability to create the test environments, production environments, multiple databases. Because in India, you know, we had several experiences where some of my team members regularly used to bring down the CI, CS and DB2 systems in the production. Now, the thing that customers don't understand is, in India we have a lot of talent, but a lot of talent is raw. And if you, some of you who have worked on large mainframe systems and large commercial systems would realize that if you, at least it used to happen quite a lot in previous world, that if you don't program it appropriately, it can bring down the system software components. Now, if by any chance you created only a database image for your test, but the DB2 or the database version, the database that is running is identical for across your test production development, the moment you have a very innovative programmer who doesn't know how to program, is going to bring down your production database also, because no user will be able to log on and then be able to work. These kinds of things that happen. So, during integration testing, the vendor will have access to test systems and test regions as applicable. So, we say that we assume, it is a very innocuous statement. We think that we are covering ourselves. What it means is, look at this statement, it's the intent of it is sometimes not to say what you need to say directly. What this guy is saying is, if the customer is in the United States, if I am working in my daytime in India, if there is any test region problem that is happening, I am expecting your system software programmer to be available in your night time to fix the problem so that the system is not available, continues to be available to me. That's never said here. He says test regions and integration testing, the vendor will have access to test systems and test regions as applicable. But probably you should have clearly stated that the test regions or test times, test systems are assumed to be available to the users, to the developers from 8 o'clock in the morning to 7 o'clock in the night, Indian standard time, which is 10:30 in the night to, you know, whatever time in the night, in the morning in the United States, and we are expecting a programmer or a systems programmer to be available 24/7 to solve this problem for us. We don't state this because it's a sales cycle. It's very difficult to state these parameters because, you know, you are afraid that you will get disqualified. But when it comes to actual implementation, all unreasonable progress in software has been made, all the decent progress in software engineering has been made by salespeople who are unreasonable, because they don't know what they are committing, They commit and then you have to deliver. Okay. Some of these guys make this statement and then they get away with it because the deal is booked and then the revenue is done, bonus obtained. So now you are left with the baby. And here we are saying, all of you know what a UAT stands for? Yeah, some of you, anybody who doesn't know what a UAT is? Okay. User acceptance testing, planning and execution will be responsibility of the customer. Okay. And here, again, on the deployment of infrastructure, again he has given a set of assumptions. During acceptance period, all dependent applications interface are up and running. Okay. If not, the vendor will not be held accountable for the downtime. Any unnecessary downtime may result in the change request. Now you can imagine how complex it is in terms of project management. What you are saying is, you have done your development, you have done your testing, you have done your integration testing. Now it has come to the stage of interface testing. Now this system has interfaces to your financial system, your materials management system, your production planning system, your payroll system, whatever those systems are. And as part of your integration testing, you have to ensure that everything that is expected by the receiving systems is being provided, everything that is coming from the sending systems is actually in the order and format that you want them. This is what you do as part of your integration testing. Now the thing is, at some point of time, their payroll system, their financial system is out. Now, how are you going to quantify that N number of people or X number of people are actually waiting and doing nothing just because their production system is down? So the customer, the first question that customer will ask is, no, probably they should have done the next phase of testing. Probably they should have done user access, usability testing. Probably they should have done load testing. Stress testing. Now it becomes a huge exercise. Now the problem that we have is the set of people who are doing integration testing for X module, just because the system is down, cannot be redeployed to do the stress testing for Y module because the competencies needed are extremely different. Now you cannot go back and then say, but look boss, you know what I have is BTEC fresh. Okay. With lot of difficulty they are able to do one testing, so how can I transfer them to load testing, you know. You cannot make this comment. So you are stuck with the question of arguing, counter arguing. So these are the issues that, you know, project management, if you have competent programmers with 7 years of programming experience in either assembly, Java, J2E and Oracle or SQL, and if all the programmers are competent, probably you don't need a project manager. If users are competent, if programmers are competent, project manager duty will only be to collect checks, but the ideal duty will be very, very different when it happens. Okay. And here also a network connection between the customer and vendor will be established in the first month of the project. It used to be a major exercise earlier. Okay. It used to take 3 months, 4 months. Now it doesn't. But the problem is, it's not very easy because especially if you work with healthcare firms, if you work with financial service institutions, the nature of firewalls that they have to be able to do anything decent in them is going to take enormous amount of time because they would like to create a private LAN in your department. So the first thing that they don't know, because only those people who are working on this project should have an access to my network. The second thing is, while they are accessing the network, they should not have any other access because their LAN should not be connected to the company LAN. Now, which means that if they can't access the company LAN, they can't get any messages even from the CEO. If there is a fire in the company and the system says that you get down because there is a visarjan and then you can go at 3 o'clock, that message has to be physically communicated to them because they are not on the LAN. And similar issues exist on the customer side too. So these issues will take a lot of time to resolve. Now, having done all these things, still the project can get into problems. Let's see what kind of a problems. I just presented an architecture, not that it is a right architecture or a wrong architecture, but just to give you an impression as to what kind of things are existing in the company. For example, we have an internal user who works on a PC. He could be working on one version of our operating system, one version of the browser. Then you have a WAN, you have a HTTP server, which is going to the UPS application, and then UPS is one of the applications that we are talking, not uninterrupted power supply, okay. Then there is a security server, then there is a directory marker server, then there is a database, and there are some connectivities and APIs that go to PeopleSoft. In a typical environment of an architecture, when you build something, by the time somebody who is here, user is accessing somebody, some data that is here, there are probably about 11 pieces of software that exist between this and this. Okay. You take operating system, you take workflow systems, you take security servers, you take transaction process, you take messaging services, you take application servers, and your own layers of how you build the architecture. So there is about 11 layers that happen between here and here. Now the catch is, if anything changes, your system is in question. Because just because you use something, it doesn't mean that it doesn't undergo a change. For example, if WebSphere comes with a new version of the software, then everything that you have done may or may not really hold good, if not in terms of functionality, but in terms of efficiency. I remember there was one project that we did on a motor financing system for one of the large financing companies in the world. When we built the system, we said that the application integrity will be maintained by committed the database level. Okay. So that was committed, and then we said that database commits will be done for a logical transaction, we will do that. But during the course of the project, it was found that we had to get an application server to maintain the performance throughputs of the for system. We chose application server as WebSphere. And then the architect and then the designer found out that it is possible to implement a logical commit at the application server level and not at the database level. It's far more easier if you do it at a WebSphere level as opposed to Oracle level, because you are in control. At the programmer level, it's more transparent. This entire system was done and was put into production, and the customer's architects found out at the time of rolling it into production that you moved the logical commit from a database level to application server level. They rejected the application. There's nothing wrong virtually in what has been done. It is technically correct. It is detailed. The customer said, you didn't take my approval. So this point will be negotiated, how to write off X number of change management request amount. Because ultimately, I think all of us should realize that a project management is a business proposition. Right? You are in that to make maximum money for your company, and the customer is in that to get the system with the least expense to him. If you don't understand this dynamics, then you will see that it's only technology project. So the first thing that he will say is, no, but I didn't do that. So you know that to change this logical commit from application server back to the database is going to take X number of effort, X number of months, all stage schedules will be delayed, you will be penalized for that, and all your programs will become totally unreadable because of the fact that you are taking it out. Boss, forgive me, I have not taken the permission, so what do I do now? So write off these $350,000 change management requests. No, otherwise, system doesn't go into production. It's a very simple, very tough negotiation that happens in a commercial environment. Now, what is the right technology for the project? There is no real answer. I think it's like saying, who is very beautiful, or they are all very perceptive statements. What is the right technology for a project? Okay, it's available, should satisfy the functional requirements, satisfy the look and feel, scalability, stability, proven architectures, maintenance possibility, support of the customer, number of installations. You can have any number of parameters on which you evaluate, and ultimately it will come to cost also, because somebody has to pay for that. How much is going to cost, and there are software that come almost free, and why is not Linux as popular as Microsoft, even though it's a free software? Because people have a tendency to believe that if I have a problem in Linux, who's going to fix it for me? if I put it into production. Now, I will tell you one example as to how we judged three kinds of a software. One is on a business component, another is on user interface communication, and the third was user interface presentation. Now, the parameters on which it was judged was functional requirements, look and feel, how functionality is accessed, is it stable, how easy to extend the services, what kind of a support is available, and do we have the source code or not, okay? And overall, how do you rate it? So each of these parameters is rated on 1, 2, 5, about 7 to 8 parameters, and we say that if it is a full circle, it is a perfect fit, okay? As shown here, if it is an empty circle, it is a completely no fit. So this is a standard way of four quadrants any consultant would do, any assessment, to say that. So we are saying that, you know, WinFX is not appropriate in this situation, whereas CG framework that was probably proprietarily developed by us is the most appropriate. Whereas for UI communication, Atlas is right, but Ajax Infralogistics is probably not appropriate. Again, if you look at UI presentation, we are saying we have to go either with Ajax or Smart Client or ASP.NET. So this is how you present a, because at some point of time there will be a question about why you chose what you chose. And if you are an architect for a system, it is your responsibility to guarantee that those questions are appropriately answered ahead of time rather than during the course of the project. Frequent changes to requirements, architecture and development. Okay. Now, I long time ago in 1987 or 88, there was a project that was, there is an RFP that was issued from a Gulf country, and it said that we would like to build a system for Ministry of Finance. Okay. Ministry of Finance needs a system to do accounts receivable, accounts payable and all that kind of stuff. So some 10 programmers, you know, some just coming from abroad or those who are waiting for projects, all those 10 people are bundled together and then, you know, asked to make an estimate. The best estimate everybody made, you know, 1988-89 software nobody used to pay, and then dollar was about 7.5 Indian rupees. So we came up with a estimate of 1 crore. It was, I think, you know, Professor Kelkar was also there in those times in that company that I am talking about. Okay. So Ministry of Finance, the proposal was submitted, and what we thought when we made the entire proposal was, this proposal for finance was a Ministry of Finance in that government. So what we realized at the, you know, because it was a global tender, we made a tender and then, you know, we made a proposal of about 1 crore or 2 crores. What they said was Ministry of Finance for the country of that. So finance department for the country wanted to do the entire thing. So from a department, the scope increased to the country. Okay. And we made a quotation of 1 crore. Okay. And they said you are the least bidder, you are awarded the project. So you can imagine the kind of a confusion that happens, you know. And you know, naturally, you know, the tugs have to be pulled at the highest level to tell them that, look, boss, we made a mistake, so we can still do that, but 1 crore is too low, it is order of 10 crores, 15 crores. Those kinds of things had to happen. The second thing is, when you estimate, one of the things that you do is that, you know, normally any estimate has a simple, medium, complex. And then there is a extremely dangerous thing called very complex, okay. So you say that simple program will take a week, medium program will take 2 weeks, complex program will take 4 weeks. Use case, you call it, you know, use case, you call it program, you call it method, you call it, you know, whatever that case is. So this 4 weeks, you know, will go to 6 weeks or 8 weeks. Now it comes to very complex, it's almost impossible to put more than 16 weeks there, because psychologically, how can you put anything more than twice than a very complex one? But now you realize when you put a estimate of 16 weeks or 8 weeks or 12 weeks for something very complex. So very complex will be something like that, you know, guaranteeing workflow between all the transactions from end to end. Okay. So you do the here, there, and then talk to one or two people and then say put very complex and put 16 weeks, you know. that will be a system by itself. A very complex can turn out to be 20 complex as opposed to 2 complex. So, at any point of time, if you see an estimate which says very complex 1 and 8 weeks for that or 80 weeks for that, the first thing is to reject it, because you know there is nothing like very complex. Very complex means it could be a system or it could be complex plus 1 day. Okay? So, those can be extraordinarily judgmental things that can send the entire project profitability down south. Of course, business needs change to the customer, requirements are not clearly defined and elaborated, and all of you must have seen that standard diagram where a customer wanted a jhula or a swing, and what he ends up getting is a noose around his neck. Okay? And change in management to the customer and change in the lead architect. Now, this is a extremely dangerous thing, because there is nothing to do with you or him, nothing to do with the vendor, nothing to do with the technology. Large companies have these mergers and acquisitions. A company gets acquired, and let us say you are building a sales order processing system for X company, and that company gets acquired by another company. First of all, that depending on who is the boss, you know, because there is no merger. People talk mergers and acquisitions, there is only acquisition, there is no merger, because merger means there is equals. There is always a unwritten law, who is the boss, even in a marriage or a acquisition. So, there is an acquirer and there is an acquired. So, it is very clear definition. So, even you say merger, very clearly there is somebody who is getting merged with. Okay? That guy who is getting merged with does not have too much of a choice about what software is being used. So, if the acquirer has a sales order processing system that is good or bad or ugly, the acquirer people have normally a collar up tendency. So, they would like to say, no, we are not going to change anything for the acquired company. So, just use this. So, if you are doing work for the acquired company, then all your systems, all your efforts will go for a toss. Okay? That is an extreme example. But the CIOs change. CIOs normally have a life cycle, a shelf life of about 3 years. You know, if you are more than 3 years, you are doing something extraordinarily wrong, because you need to get fired after 3 years. You know, personal people and CIOs need to get fired every 3 years. Otherwise, you are not keeping pace with technology. Now, if this guy is there and a new CIO comes in, he may not like, you know, Microsoft, you know, for whatever is the reason, or he may not like Sun, he may not like IBM, because is not being treated well in the last business meeting, or his dinner table was not adjacent to Steve Ballmer. I mean, it does not have to be anything, you know, remotely connected to technical. You know. So, entire thing goes for a change. So, you got to redefine entire priorities and then go back and then redefine the requirements. Of course, I do not have to elaborate on what is the drawback of the frequent changes. Okay. So, how do you do this? You know, one of the things that people make a mistake is this. When you get into business and when you get into software business, especially with a Western customer, you have to have a phenomenal ability to deal with unpleasantness. Okay? So, it's a characteristic that you have to build. Okay? Because, you know, let's say that there's a change request. You know, you raise a change request for 150 days is what you have spent. You want money for 150 days multiplied by, say, $25 an hour, 25 multiplied by 80, 200. Multiplied by 100, $30,000 is what you have raised, what you want to raise the invoice for. Now, 3 or 4 things happen. Okay? One is that you have to ask for money. Okay? Whenever you ask for money, lot of Indians have the tendency to believe that you are actually asking for a favor. I mean, you know, there is a tendency that you are like a beggar. Project, you know, why should I ask my money? You know, what is this? My CEO should ask, my CEO should ask, you know. CIOs, CEOs don't ask for money. We have to maintain the relationship. If we become the bad boys, who will be the good boy? I think a lot of people don't realize this, that you know, what is that guy doing in the cabin? He should ask for money. My work is technology. Okay? Technology is not your work. Getting money for your work is what your work is. $30,000. So, first of all, you don't want to ask money. Second thing is, you are extremely worried that if I ask for money and then be tough with him, he will screw my happiness as the day goes along. Because the project is not going to end today, right? It is going to run for 6 months, 9 months, 12 months. This guy is going to make my life miserable. Okay? So, why pick up this unpleasantness? You know, let's be nice to him. But nice to him means you are going to lose money. So there is no, there is a, we say in business there are three sides of a triangle. The first corner of a triangle is customer, second corner of a triangle is a shareholder, third corner of a triangle is an employee. You can always make one of them extremely happy. If you can make your customers happy by not charging them anything, okay, your shareholders will be extremely unhappy. Okay. If you charge a lot to a customer, okay, to deliver something and then keep your shareholders and employees happy, your customer is going to be extremely unhappy. Okay. So the entire management that we do on a day-to-day basis is to balance these three sides of the triangle. How do you compromise? How do you make a strike a balance between a customer, an employee, and a shareholder? Okay. Dealing with unpleasantness is a trait that all of us have to develop. I think, you know, that if I learned something over the past few years in a multinational company is the ability to deal with unpleasantness and not give up. Because you don't, another tendency is, you know, after issue drags on for few weeks and few months, somehow settle it and go on with the life. There is no somehow settlement, you know. In every settlement, there is a winner, there is a loser, okay. And it is your duty to be on the winning side, okay. You have to struggle as hard as, and there is nothing like greed. Eh? I mean, greed is okay, okay. It is sometimes good, okay. So, you have to struggle to make that money. And the third thing that lot of people make an assumption is that, status report is sent, okay. First of all, you know, when you say that, look, you know, but you said that, you know, if you do this kind of a change now, it's going to cost us 100 days more. Did you tell the customer? Yes, yes, I told him. When did you tell him? I told him in the conference call. In conference call, there is, you know, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock in the evening, you are taking the conference call. Who said what? Who remembered what? Nobody knows, okay. First thing is, you have to minute it. Okay, and you have to document it. If you send a status report, normally the number of emails that we receive, any executive receives in this in a business world is about 250. So if you open a mail, I get about 250 mails a day. If you get a 250 mails a day, if you look at that, if you are not the primary receiver of the mail, you normally ignore it. That's a golden rule. If you mark to 20 different people, nobody responds to it, okay. Now, if you sent a status report to the customer engagement manager or customer representative or customer vice president, it is your duty to walk him through that status report and highlight those issues for which you need his attention or her attention. If you didn't do that, your status report is as good as not written. So, oral communication, absolutely unacceptable. Status report, better. But status report that is walked through on a weekly call or a monthly call or a steering committee meeting is the need. Otherwise, you know, it's your statement against my statement. But, you know, it's never, people will always say, I didn't have time. Okay. Effort estimate for each change request should be done and the impact on the project schedule analyzed. I think once you have this, once you have the mechanism of identifying a change, impact of the change, cost of the change, cost in terms of both money, time and schedule, you can do all these things. But my biggest issue is this, okay. People tend to be ambiguous because they are afraid of unpleasantness, okay. So this, and I think, you know, my feeling is, each time I have dealt with these kind of situations, if you are firm on your ground, you tend to get a respect. You know, I think, you know, you don't assume that because you are trying to be very demanding on the money that you need to get, customer will not respect you. Customer, in fact, will respect you more than the other way around. Okay? We talked about this. Okay? Skills specific to your project are not known. You get the people, but the project doesn't start on time. Let's say that you started you won a big deal for one of the largest companies, you hired 150 people. So by the time the contract gets signed and both side lawyers agree and then dash the T's, it's Thanksgiving weekend, November. So November to Christmas, nothing happens in the United States. So you have about 150 people on the bench staring at you, you know, looking, sitting in the library. Okay. And there's only so many library management systems that you can develop, right? Because you have, every company has about 50 library management systems, you know. Every guy who's on the bench is only developing library management systems, you know. So you get very sick with it, and then you redeploy them into other projects. Okay. On the January 1st, the project starts. Now what do you do with these guys? You know? Where are the guys? There's nobody there in the project. Because, you know, I want you to realize that if you get the average cost of an employee, of an employed person, in this industry is about $12 to $15 an hour. Okay. So if companies like Infosys, you know how much margin they are making. Say, let's say they are making 25%. They are making 25% margin when they are charging $25. Okay. Including, you know, just because the product doesn't come through at the right time, you know, my salary doesn't get reduced, right? The CEO salary will remain the same. The VP will get the same salary. The infrastructure will get the same. If you take in a space of 200 people, that space cannot be leased out for 2 months and then reclaimed back after 2 months. So, on an average, you find in the software industry that if you are spending 100 rupees as a cost, about 60 to 65 goes in the direct people, direct cost of the people, which is salary. Almost 35 to 40 bucks go in infrastructure cost, sales and general administration, infrastructure, network, all that kind of stuff. Now, that cost is a sunken cost. I mean, the VP doesn't take less salary, the PRM department will continue to be the same, the HR department will be there, finance will be there, legal will be there. That 40 can never be recovered, okay? So that money is lost. Now your total problem is, how do you stop these projects? And especially suddenly some guy will say that I want NetWeaver 150 people. I don't know how many of you have heard something called NetWeaver. You know, NetWeaver is a latest software that has come from for system integration from SAP. That's a hot software, okay? The fact is that if you know Java tremendously well, you can be trained on NetWeaver for 2 weeks. Within 2 weeks, you can be a productive programmer. But customers sometimes will ask, they also know that NetWeaver is very tough, but if you have 100 programmers, they at least want 20 to be knowing NetWeaver. All 100 cannot be trained. Now, these issues come up regularly. Most of it is being addressed today by training, you know, all the companies today, if you look at software companies, have extraordinarily strong infrastructure and training. Okay, because we can't, you know, this technology changes so fast, you can't have everybody skilled on everything to be available to you on the time. So it will cost you too much. I just talked about infrastructure, load set, and connectivity. So most of the time, what you do is that you have a network already available for which you just hook this connectivity. For example, if you look at Capgemini today, we are connected from Bombay to Singapore, Bombay to London, Bombay to New York, Bombay to Chicago. Okay. Now, each of these pipes is an unlimited capacity pipe of France Telecom. Okay. Now, if you get a project, what you need to do is connect from Chicago to say, let's say that we got a project in Atlanta. You get from Chicago to Atlanta, that's the only connectivity that you have to establish. Rest of all goes on to this network. So you are limiting this problem of establishing connectivity, because for quite some time, if you remember in the, some of you may or may not know, in the starting of the software industry, most of the communication link was point to point. Okay. If you got a customer, you establish a link between Bombay and Phoenix, Bombay and Atlanta. Now we don't know, we no longer do that. We have a pipe, we hook onto the pipe. And options have also increased. Today we have VPN, we have internet connection, we have point-to-point communication, and then we have these networks. Another thing that you have to be conscious of is, it's very easy to order a 30 gigabyte line and not use it. It's very easy, no? You know, because, but who pays for it? So, entire again a project management, you know, when you look at a project management profitability, we calculate the profitability based on every cost that goes with it. You know, we just can't say that, look, you know, you ordered a network means you ordered a network. So this is going to be the key as we go along. This is an interesting thing, you know, iterative development, we think it will solve the problem. So one of the reasons is every month you are delivering something, okay. Now everybody thinks the incremental delivery is an intermediate delivery. That doesn't have to be accepted, and it's okay, you know. Normally it is mistaken as your eagerness to prove that you are doing things right to the customer, okay, rather than a serious delivery. So what happens is, you know, delivery comes, it is stored in a directory, second delivery comes, second directory, third delivery, third directory. When you come to the fourth delivery, somebody will start testing it and say, no, no, this is not what we want. But you say, but no, that has already been delivered in delivery one. So we didn't accept it. Now again, if you look at this thing, you know, it's very easy to say that, look, you know, I accept you, I did the delivery on June 1st, you didn't accept, it's your problem. My assumptions, if you look at that, within 5 days, if you don't deliver, you are wrong, I am right, so get lost. He'll say, thank you, get lost, okay. The biggest problem with this is, customer is a god, okay. You can't mess with him, okay. You cannot say that I am right, you are wrong, so go means, you know, they say, go, thank you. There is Infosys, there is TCS, there is Wipro, Cognizant, Accenture, EDS, IBM. He'll just say, pick up a phone, there are 10 customers waiting saying that how wrong we were, how inflexible they were and how flexible they would be, okay. Okay. You can never take the chance. So in each of these cases, the issue is not that the people who are involved know how to handle the situation. They know, but they have to manage the commercial aspect of the relationship. There is no way that you can walk out from a Fortune 1000 customer just because their user acceptance delayed by 1 week, okay. And always the sales guy will tell you that there is only a $10 million deal, there is a $1 billion in the pipe, okay. You complete this, there is a $1 billion coming in the pipe. So you always let down the garden path saying that there is something that is big coming up. Another thing that we do is that we normally store the test plans, test scripts, test data for that release, okay. Now you say that you haven't accepted this, but this system is not supposed to work like that, but you know, you said it is working, where is the proof? So what we normally do is, you know, provide the test data, test plan is what we have tested. Look, we actually tested, if you don't believe us, you know, look at it once more. You know. So regression testing becomes, how many of you understand the term regression testing? So regression testing is ensuring that the changes that you have made to the system have not messed with the functionality that already exists or the performance which you have. So the regression test seat and test data is always kept. And again, documentation, all this issue of performance, the software process compliance, CMMI level 5, or you talk about ISO 9001 compliance becomes very important, because as a process you are forced to do these things. I mean, what is the value addition that you get by following a CMMI level 5 or what are these things? So the thing that you get is you have no option but to record and store these things if you are a CMMI level 5 company. So it's not left to your discretion whether you can do something or not do something. You got to do that. Now in any of these things, that what we do is this, we create what we call a RACI chart. Responsible, accountable, consulted, informed, verifies and signs off. So for every activity, we create a RACI chart and a VS, okay. So the people whose neck is on the line is the guys who are responsible and accountable, consulted, informed, verifies and signs off. I just show you one activity, one RACI chart. Look at a logical data model. On a logical data model, the customer is consulted, he verifies, he signs off. The vendor is responsible and accountable, okay. On software architecture document, the customer signs off, vendor is responsible and accountable, okay. For example, analysis model, customer signs off, he is responsible and accountable, okay. Like that, on requirement traceability matrix, customer is just informed, That is, this use case is translating into these methods, these programs, these databases. Okay. Again, the vendor is responsible, accountable. So you make this chart, and first of all, you have to do is agree on this chart. If you don't agree on this chart, it's always a debate. Who is responsible for what? One of the, how do you answer this question? By creating a RACI chart, saying that, look, you know, this is the activities, this is the responsibility, and you agree. Having this chart doesn't mean it will solve all the problems, but it tested at least to the beginning point. Okay. Other thing that I wanted to show you is quick demonstration of the issues log. Now you have several issues in the project. Now, normally, it can't be a set of emails. Issues have to have an ID. They need to have a description, the date it was raised, the date it was closed, what is the severity of it, what is the status, whom is it assigned to, what is the resolution summary, what is the date resolved, what is the impact of if not resolved. Okay. So at a periodic intervals, normally what the steering committee will do is go through the issue log, look at all issues that are of high severity and which have been raised more than 3 months ago or 1 month ago and are still unclosed. That gives a very quick summary of where the project stands. So management will take a different slicing and dicing techniques even on this issue resolution databases to find out what kind of natures, what kind of problems are happening in a project. Okay. Now let me just quickly go back to the starting. Who is responsible for what? We said we will do it with a RACI chart. What is the right technology for the project? We said that we have to do proof of concepts, complete evaluation on various 7 to 8 parameters to see what is right. Frequent changes to requirements, change control, dealing with unpleasantness, status reports that are discussed. Staffing, having a clarity on the staffing and the nature of skills required, the training solutions. Infrastructure load set and connectivity, having a network architecture that is foolproof, redundant, rugged and redeployable. And backlog of acceptance and incrementally delivered project. So some of the examples I have said, you know, this probably the issues that I have covered and tried to cover in 1.5 hours are not even 5% of the issues that you face in a real life project. Okay. My idea was to show you a sample that the practice is very different. Now, one message that I don't want to you to take is that theory is not important. Okay. So all these are important provided you have the technology content. If you don't have the technology content, you don't even reach the stage that you have to deal with these issues. If you are not a good development shop, if you can't code, design, test systems properly, there is no customer for you. So if you do, assuming that you need to do, that you can do all these things right, this is a layer of packaging that is needed around it to make you successful. But if you think that the packaging is important and the content is not, you have missed the point. That is never the intent of my lecture at least. So I just want to reinforce the RARUP methodology, your ability to design good systems, your ability to design methods, your ability to design performance sensitive SQL code, your ability to use Microsoft Project or relational tools or load balancing tool sets, clustering of servers, choose an application. Everything is important, but over and above, those are necessary, but not sufficient. Okay. That's all I had to say. I think I have about 10-15 minutes for some questioning before Ganapati Bappa takes over. So, anything that you want to ask me? Sure. Thank you.